The Dharma, incomparably profound and exquisite, is rarely met with, even in hundreds of thousands and millions of countless. We now can see it, hear it, accept and hold it. May we realize the true mind of the Tathagata. Today is already day 5 of this 7-day session here at Mountain Gate in July 2017. During the rainy season, and it's clouded over, we hope, like yesterday, we'll get a nice, good, solid rain. We're not like eastern rainstorms where it can go all day long or even for several days in a row, or like Japan where it's quite like that, or even more like Rangoon where when we moved there, it was during the rainy season and we did not see sunlight for 6 weeks, and then it was just one tiny little shaft that came down through the clouds and went right back up again. People carried umbrellas everywhere. Somewhere around the middle way is what we'd like here, because we do have fruit trees that need water, and the neighbors have their animals that they raise feed for, so it would be nice to have a little bit more rain than sometimes happens. Today I would like to share some classical sayings from Zen, and actually some of them are quite old, even dating back to China. At Hidden Valley Zen Center, there is a beautiful scroll that was brushed by the Kansho, one of the Kansho of Myoshinji, in many years past. A Kansho is the head abbot. Myoshinji is a headquarters temple of the Rinzai sect, and it's the one that Sogenji is connected to, and it's rather a massive accumulation of temples all in one large compound. There are 44 sub temples, and so the Kansho is ahead of all of it. These days, thanks to the Meiji Restoration and all the political challenges that happened for Buddhism in that era, there was a great deal of prejudice against Buddhism. There was a great deal of aggression and violence against Buddhism, and temples were destroyed, and the plug was pulled on the support for most of them, actually. And that is why, of these 44 temples that are the main sub-temples of Myoshinji, there's only 4 of them that are actually teaching temples. There's also a temple that survives financially by being a tourist temple. It's got a beautiful Zen garden. There are 2 that operate as bed and breakfasts, where you actually can do Zazen in the Zendo if you want in the morning. And there's at least 1 that is a nursery school kindergarten. It's quite an interesting walk through that enclave. And one day when I was at a laundromat, this is in Kyoto, by the way, I happened to be visiting Kyoto and doing some laundry in a laundromat. Japanese laundromats are like toys. Tiny little washing machines and tiny little dryers and tiny little boxes of soap that you can get out of a dispensing machine for a great deal of money. And so I was coming back, and I was held back on this path, road really. The roads in Japan are often not any wider than the space between these tons here in the Zendo. That's why they have some rather small cars. And also held back was a large class of 3-year-olds. And they were obviously filming something. And so then when they got the go-ahead, the kids all ran through, and then I followed. And as I rounded the corner, no one else in sight in this ancient temple compound, there was a samurai in full dress, and his sidekick, whatever you want to call it, and he said, "Ohayou gozaimasu," boss, in a very deep voice that Japanese men sometimes have. It was like something out of a dream. At any rate, this scroll at Hidden Valley Zen Center, which was a gift of a Rinzai master who was in the Myoshinji lineage. He wasn't from Sogenji, he was from Shogenji, which is a sister temple of Sogenji in a different part of Japan. Reads, "When the eight winds blow, it is not disturbed." When the eight winds blow, it is not disturbed. The eight winds are various different outward conditions, and let me read them. They are, it's described here in this book, The One Taste of Truth, Zen and the Art of Tasting Tea. The eight winds are the eight feelings that delude and perplex humankind. Gain, loss, censure, praise, fame, loss of reputation, bitterness, and pleasure. Would you have guessed that pleasure was in that? There's also a sort of a teaching story about a man in a large, expensive house that heard a knock on the door. And he went to open it, and there's this beautiful woman, young, beautiful woman, standing there saying, "May I please come in?" "Of course. And in she went, and the door was closed, and presently there's another knock, and he goes to open it, and there's this hag, this ugly person standing there, and she rasps, "Can I come in?" And he says, "Forget it. You can't come in. No, you can't come in. Go away." And she says, "I have to come in. My sister is there. She is pleasure. I am pain. Pain always follows pleasure. Let me in." So, when we have a period of happiness, it's so easy to get attached to it. And then it begins to slip away, or something else comes in its place to disturb it. We get upset. Unless, of course, we've done a deep amount of Zen practice. And then it is much more like this scroll. Though the eight winds may blow, it is not disturbed. What is this it? What is this it? In another saying, there's a verse to the Mumonkan from another writing, and it says, "One thought sees through the unlimited. The unlimited is exactly just now. If you can see through this moment's single thought, you will see through the one who sees through it." I'm not sure thought is the actual accurate translation, but we can call it that. One thought sees through the unlimited. The unlimited is exactly just now, when we are totally present. There are no boundaries in the very best sense of the word. There's no separation between ourselves or what we ordinarily think of as ourselves, and all things. This is a place that Dogen talked about when he said to follow the way. is to discover the self. And when we explore the self, it means forgetting the self. And when we forget the self, we are enlightened by the 10,000 things. And then he follows it up by saying, to be enlightened by the 10,000 things is to remove the barrier between self and other. Now, this is very different from the psychological sense of self. If we don't have barriers, not barriers, boundaries, if we don't have boundaries and understand the nature of boundaries, we're going to wander willy-nilly through life being caught by any number of things. This is a very, very different, very deep meaning. To study the way is to study the self. To study the self is to forget the self. And we forget the self by going profoundly into the out-breath, giving everything to it, allowing whatever it is that brought us to practice, this nameless sense, to draw us deep within, to forget the self, this artificial construct that needs to be defended, that needs to be upheld, that gets embarrassed, that gets insulted. So what do we open to when we do that? Here's another one. In Japanese, it's Jakunen Fudo, translated as at peace and unmoved. And that is the nature of our true mind. At peace and unmoved. That's the it, except it's not an it. You can't put your finger on it. But language is limited, and so it's the best we can come up with. Change is without thought. It is without fabrication. It is at peace and unmoved. When conscious, it pervades all the phenomena under heaven. Without having reached the highest spiritual state, how can you take part in this? This is a commentary from the I Ching. And Lao Tzu, in the Tao Te Ching, writes about the ungraspable. That's another way to speak of it. It is quiet and tranquil, empty and at rest. It stands on its own and cannot be altered. Manifests itself in all things and is never idle. When we chant the Prajnaparamita and chant form is emptiness, emptiness is form, it's too easy to assume that emptiness is sort of like an empty box, nothing in it. But this emptiness is alive, rich, filled with potential. In Christianity, they actually got a sense of this when they spoke in Genesis of God making all things. There's nobody outside of us making things. In our own mind, we are creating. And it's so important not to attach to what is created. When we don't have that attachment, we don't have that tug in our chest, needing things to be a certain way, then there's a profound peace that we can move in everything we do. And life unfolds. Even if it's chaotic, even if it's difficult, even if it's challenging, we're able to navigate it simply without any stickiness, with no Velcro. And I have an image that goes with practice, or perhaps describes practice. When we come to practice, we're covered in Velcro. And you know that Velcro is two parts. There's the little hook part and there's the fuzzy part. And when one hits the other, they stick together. And so we have one or the other on us. And as soon as we meet anything that's got the partner part, we get caught in attachment. And as we go deeper and deeper in our practice, we're little by little dropping those pieces of Velcro. So that more and more we're able to move through life without getting stuck. This is the tremendous gift of practice. And ultimately, if we go far enough, and it takes a long time and a lot of work to go that far, but once we are on this path deeply enough, we recognize that we really don't have a choice. Do we really want to go back to how it was? Do we really want to go back to more pain and suffering, having seen through a certain amount of it and recognizing that it was unnecessary and came forth only because of our attachments? And so eventually we are able to manifest that saying, though the eight winds may blow, it is not disturbed. Jacques Le Saron, after he had his deep awakening in Buchenwald, was able to experience it like that. Still, he was in the group of invalids and elderly men and young boys. But this time, after that, no one stole his bread. Our karma changes. When, as we do this important work of letting go, of seeing through this artificial self-image and opening to a deeper truth that brings about a real sense of freedom and a real ability to move freely in the world. That he could find joy in the midst of that hell realm is an expression of this. I have a friend who was a senior student of one of my Dharma sisters, and he went to the ER one day with his wife because his hands and feet were swelling, and they were trying to figure out what was going on, and they did some lab tests, and they were waiting for the results to come back, and in the meantime, a group of people who had been in a bad car accident came in. And so the staff was busy trying to deal with that. And he said to his wife, you know, these people are in much worse state of health than we are, so let's just leave. And his wife said, no, you know, they did the blood work and they said, wait for the results. So I think we really should wait. And so they waited, and it was a good thing that they did, because it turned out that he had an extremely aggressive, very fast-acting leukemia. And if he had waited, he would have been dead in 2 days. That was what they told him. So in order to start chemo, they had to bring him into good enough health, because he was in such a bad state, apparently, that they didn't dare give him chemo right then. And so they miraculously were able to bring him back to a sufficient level of health in a couple of weeks in the hospital that they could start chemo. He was in the hospital for 7 months. Three times his family was called in to say goodbye to him. The last time that that happened, he told me that he found himself in hell. And when he was in hell, he was surprised to see this elderly man with kindly eyes moving through the hell realm there. And he was puzzled as to why somebody so kind could end up in hell. The man took him by the hand and led him through a sort of a semi-visible curtain into a place that was filled with peace. There were animals lying around listening to someone talking. And he led Jim over to a lion, and Jim lay down against the lion. He did recover after a bone marrow transplant, and when Sunyana Roshi took her students to Japan on pilgrimage, he went along. And one of the places they went was Sanju Sangendo, which is the hall of 10,000 Kuan Yin, or maybe it's 1,000, but anyway, there's a lot of standing Kuan Yin figures and an enormous multi-armed figure in the center of it. The name of the building refers to the actual dimensions of it. Sanju Sangendo, it's the hall of 33, and it's a traditional Japanese measurement. It's a very, very long hall, and in fact, in the back hall of it, they used to do archery competitions, and as you go through the back of the building, yeah, there are quite a clot of arrows stuck in the woodwork there. At any rate, there are all these rows and rows and rows of exquisite gold standing Kuan Yin, and or Kanon in Japanese, and there were done by their life size, and they were carved by a number of different artists, and they're in tiers. And then in front of the whole thing, leading up to this main figure of Kuan Yin, are a number of other figures. And one of them is a sort of three-quarter life-size wooden carving, very lifelike wooden carving of an elderly man dressed from the waist down in animal skins, and he's holding a rolled up scroll in his hand. And when Jim saw that, he said, "That is who led me out of hell." It turns out that the figure was Basu Sennin, Sennin meaning a mountain hermit, and that he had taken a vow never to cease practice until he led every suffering being out of hell. At any rate, as we deepen our practice, we find ourselves more free. We also find ourselves more aware, and therefore, in a certain way, more sensitive. More aware of our own emotions, more aware of what's going on around us. And this offers another tremendous opportunity to work on letting go of those eight winds. As our practice progresses, we do that. In a certain way, that's the nature of practice. As we go deeper and deeper and deeper within, brought there through the out-breath, we become quite aware of what's going on inside us at a given time. We become aware of where we're caught. and anger and greed. And there again is the opportunity to work with that by tuning in to the energy of it. In which case, if we tune in 100%, it will shift and release. And it weakens the habit pattern that has brought it up. And gradually, as time goes on, we find ourselves with more and more an immovable mind, in the best sense of the word, able to flow with life. There's another saying about the rapidly running water does not carry the moon along. When we see a stream that's moving rapidly on a moonlit night, the moon stays in one place, silent and serene, despite the fact that the water is moving rapidly under it. So it becomes possible that no matter what the circumstances are, and hopefully none of us will ever experience anything as extreme as Jacques Lacéran did, or as painful as Jim did. But whatever does come to us in this life, we will be able to move seamlessly with it without being caught by any ideas about it, being fully present, and as a result, fully free. This is advanced functioning. This comes, as far as I know, only as a result of deepening, deepening, deepening practice. Even if someone has a spontaneous awakening, as Flora Courtois did, spontaneous in the sense that it happened suddenly, but there certainly was a lot of questioning that preceded it, and she got deeper and deeper in her questioning, but she had no access to any spiritual practice that was able to help her expand and deepen that awakening until 20 years later. She moved to California after university, after she got married, and eventually found herself in Miyazumi Roshi's Zendo, and then continued practicing. But when we have an awakening out of context, so to speak, it doesn't always work. It doesn't always last. Many, many years ago, I think it was in the 1960s, a man came to visit Kapla Roshi. He had been in the invasion of Normandy and had survived, and he was so struck by the suffering that he witnessed that all he could do was wander around New York City on foot, so caught in this question of why is there so much suffering, that he'd bump into street lights and all kinds of things. And after 6 months, he actually had a catch-all experience. But again, he had no context for it and no way to expand and deepen or even maintain that awareness. So by the time he came to visit Kapla Roshi, it was a dim memory. Kapla Roshi suggested that if he started doing Zazen, it would come back to him, but he never saw the man again. We have such an opportunity here, and even more so on day 5 of Sesshin, where our capacity to go deeper is far greater than it was on day 1 or even on day 4. It may not feel like it, but it is. So to take advantage of that. We don't know when we can come back to Sesshin. We don't know what will happen in the meantime. When I was living at the Rochester Zen Center, we heard that there was a young man who was going to be coming to be living at the center also. He never showed up. Some months later, we discovered that he had been murdered along the way. It's important when we have the opportunity to practice to give ourselves as fully as possible to it. Whatever our hindrances are, to embrace them and to keep searching. And if we persist, we cannot fail to open into a deeper truth, a reality that will set us free. Thank you for listening. We'll stop now and recite the four vows.